Good evening. Welcome to you. The city council meeting of December 4th, 2014. I'm city council president Bill Dwight. I will be presiding. This is the penultimate meeting of the year. We'll have one more Thursday, the 18th, I'm told, is our last meeting of 2014. That's actually not relevant to anything, so just me filling time.
Thank you for telling us.
Before we convene, our tradition is to allow a period of public comment where the public is invited to come up and speak on any topic of their choosing, with the caveat of, and the request, that you keep it to 3 minutes or under, and understand that as you speak to the councilors, they are not allowed to speak or participate in the conversation. So this is your time. Our time comes after you finish speaking. But so if when I call your name, please come up to the podium, state your name and address, and the floor is yours. And actually, I only have Nora Kalina listed, so.
Yes, I'm Nora Kalina, 8 Middle Street in Florence. Thank you. I'm here to support the ordinance to limit parking on Middle Street in Florence. And I've been here a couple times before, and we've been asking for help for years on the issue, and the majority of the neighbors on Middle Street polled were in favor of passing the ordinance as well. In this particular case, business is clearly not provided enough parking for their employees, and the employees have nowhere to park in certain cases, and they line our street every day. And in some cases, the business has directed the folks to park there. Our street becomes incredibly narrow, and sometimes it's really just impassable, particularly during snowstorms. It's very difficult. We did a test for a little bit of time, I don't remember how many months, where it was two-hour parking, and that helped a great deal. It made the street much more passable. There were places for people to actually go. I'm really hoping that you folks will vote in favor of this. I know that many years ago, Main Street also had a very similar issue, and two-hour ordinances were also put up on Main Street, and that was very helpful as well. So I'm asking you once again to please help us on Middle Street and vote yes on the ordinance. Thank you.
Thank you. That's all we have signed up. Is anyone else interested in speaking at this time? Okay. All right. I'll ask the secretary to call the roll, please.
Councilor Adams.
Here.
Councilor Kearney.
Present.
Councilor Blake.
Here.
Councilor Coleman.
Here.
Councilor LaBarge.
Present.
Councilor Murphy.
Here.
Councilor O'Donnell.
Here.
Councilor Schiller.
Here.
Councilor Spector.
Here.
We have a quorum, and so I call this meeting to order. And the first order of business, of course, is we don't have any public hearing scheduled for tonight. And now we have this opportunity for the mayor, communications from the mayor, to step up and speak. The mayor is here. Do you have any communications?
I just had one communication because since the last time I spoke with you, you may have read this week's paper of the decision of the Smith Vocational and Agricultural High School Board of Trustees, who voted 3-2 on Tuesday evening to give notice, effectively give 6 months notice to the city that we would need to vacate the building on their campus that's currently occupied by what's now known as our Parks and Recreation Department. And so I just wanted to report to you that we will begin a very exhaustive review of all of our available city space, as well as other potential spaces in the community. As you may or may not know, they have about 7 staff that work in that office. It's a space, for those of you who haven't been there, it was a space, a renovated former building that the rec department and the city paid for the rehabilitation of back in 1991. It was a former ROTC building on the campus. And so it has offices, it has a sort of a reception area for the many customers who come to sign up for leagues and sign up for camps. There's a conference space, storage space for a lot of the equipment that they store throughout the year. So we will we will be looking for it. And part of my reason for speaking, to giving you this heads up, is I suspect there will be a financial impact in terms of whatever that may entail, whether it's renovating existing city space or acquiring leasing space, et cetera. That's sort of my communication this evening as a heads up. And I'll continue to keep you posted on that as we have more to report on what the future is for the Parks and Recreation Department.
Thank you. There, it was a notice of essentially an eviction of sorts. Then does that mean there was an associated approval of a new tenancy?
No, there was no approval of a new tenancy, although there is a... there have been discussions with the administration with Greenfield Community College, who themselves have been looking for space because their LPN program, which was located, has been located at the VA hospital in Leeds, was given notice that they need to relocate because of space considerations at the hospital. So, and I have met with and spoken with President Pura of Greenfield Community College, and I understand the need, and I appreciate the desire to keep the program in Hampshire County, and I also appreciate and understand the synergy with a vocational school having it located there. That piece of it is still to come because as I reminded my colleagues on the Board of Trustees. The Board of Trustees is responsible for executing whatever final lease arrangement is made with Greenfield Community College. So whatever preliminary discussions have been made, have been held behind the scenes, I still have yet to review what the terms of any potential lease would be, and we need to vote on it as Board of Trustees. So that's, I assume, will be commencing soon. Yeah.
Councilor Carney, then Councilor Levin.
Just to speak to the space, having renovated that space personally, staff at Smith Folk some 20 years ago with students, I know it was at that time state of the art and a good transfer of what a former, no longer ROTC building, complete with a firing range, which would, had that been still intact, we could have been using that for the police station
yes.
now. But, I know it's a very complicated manner, and wish you all the best in trying to negotiate a good solution around that.
Okay, thank you.
Councilor LeBlanc.
Thank you. Mayor, you're on the Board of Trustees at Smith Folk, correct?
That's correct.
Nothing was ever brought up at any of the meetings or anything about possibly making this move?
It had not been the subject of any discussion at the Board of Trustees, that's correct. It was not on any... this was the first time it had been on the agenda. So
you never had any heads up on...
Well, I'd obviously been given a heads up because...
I know.
We were told it was going to be placed on the agenda. I did express concern at the meeting, and you may have heard it in the media, because there was an incident back in September where Smith officials came to the rec department during the middle of the workday and began measuring space and measuring offices. And so that was how some of the staff learned that they were informed that they were going to be not long for the space, which we didn't appreciate. And the department head, who was not in the office at the time, didn't appreciate. So I've expressed my displeasure to the chair and to the administration about the way that was handled. But that's neither here nor there. Now the vote has been taken. And so now we're in a position where we have to begin looking for new space. So stay tuned on that.
Yeah, you got that one right.
I'm just a little concerned, and maybe this requires some follow-up, and it's not necessarily even under our authority, but it sounds like there were extracurricular discussions that were not within open meeting about the process of making this offer and following through with it, unless the other trustees weren't aware of it as well. I mean, if they were all apprised of it and discuss it, not in the context of a meeting.
Well, I can't really, I can't speak to that. I can say that I did express concerns about it, and express concerns, and also just the process, given that we, there is no actual lease executed with a new tenant, yet we were voting to cancel the current lease. So, you know, one might think that, you know, you actually execute a lease with someone and know that you had that secured before you ended the current lease. So, and, you know, we did hear from the rec department and the rec commission. Tom Parent, the longtime chair, did speak before the board and expressed his concerns, and they did seek a longer period of transition, which I offered an amendment to the motion, but it was defeated. So, because again, the rec department, June, which is when this would effectively happen, when they'd have to effectively be out, is probably one of their busiest seasons in terms of camps and leagues and other things like that. So, be that as it may, that's the deadline we have, and we'll have to try to figure out a way to abide by it. So, we've made some inquiries, and we'll begin looking at space internally as well as externally.
Thank you for the heads up.
Okay.
The next item, of course, is a. And first of all, actually, before we get to this item, I'd like to thank Councilor Adams for presiding. Very efficient. Given the fact that the agenda was some 200 and some pages long in the packet, the fact that he actually thrashed through it and successfully got everyone out before 2 o'clock in the morning was
to
be commended. The city clerk commented on the fact that had I been presiding, we'd still be in session. So, thank you very much. We're now up to the second reading of the City of Northampton's trust resolution, which is supporting the mayor's executive policy orders to the police department. And it's interesting, I didn't get to watch the meeting, but the night that you were voting, curiously, was the same night that the president had announced that he agreed with us. So, and that we clearly following our lead, and to that, bravo on us. But I'll accept the motion to have a second reading on this.
Move to approve.
Second.
Okay. Any further discussion on this? This application, if someone's so inclined.
Move to approve.
Second.
And now, any discussion on this? Councilor Adams? No? Councilor O'Donnell, you look puzzled.
Well, no, I'm not puzzled. I guess it was interesting that I Googled this a little bit and found some of these concerns that you just mentioned about public safety and crime, that kind of thing. And I found that there were actually some cities that were exploring a ban on these devices. And I think that was the genesis of some of the security measures that the company is sort of touting in the materials in the packet. I actually, in looking at those, I was actually just, I'll just say it, I was kind of struck by the fact that people are giving their fingerprints and getting multiple photographs of themselves and getting their cheek swabbed or whatever the machine does to you. And that just struck me, and I don't know if anyone else has concerns about that, but that's a lot of information to give over to...
Machine.
Well, and law enforcement on a regular basis, and I don't know what rules govern the transfer of that information, if any. I will note that when I was doing more Googling here, the city of Walpole, Massachusetts, had a debate about this and passed and gave a license out to this company. And at the same time, they also looked at their old secondhand dealer ordinances and updated them substantially. That might be something we want to look at in doing this license. Maybe there are rules we could put in place that would make sure that the city of Northampton is well served by what is a new technology, I think, or a new idea that has a lot of potential to take electronics out of landfills and do good for the environment. But we might want to look at our secondhand dealer ordinance at some point and see if there's things we can augment there. Just a comment.
Any other comments on that? I mean, the one comforting part is it clearly is voluntary. It's not registering this information unless you want your quick cash for the phone. So I would imagine there are any number of people who would be reticent to do that. The plus side also, besides keeping these things out of landfill, and I believe the statistics that they present, that less than 20% of all handheld devices are recycled, and they're comprised of a lot of rare earth materials that are actually usually garnered it from communities that can't protect themselves. It's exploitive mining systems in some pretty dreary places by countries that really don't give a damn, and that there's a real black market. This is an opportunity to recycle those same materials and hopefully diminish the demand on those. But at the same time, I'm with you. I mean, I'm not so sure that I'm going to go pop my devices in there, give a thumbprint and everything else, although, I mean, seeding that much information does give one pause. And I actually like your suggestion of reconsidering. I mean, junk dealers used to be, you know, people who would accept, you know, old tires and stuff, and this is a lot different. We're bringing it up to a whole new level.
Although I would note for the record, I'd probably get more money for an old tire than the phone that I have. It's an antiquated phone. It would probably be spit back out by these kids. But our ordinances on secondhand dealers do have provisions on record keeping and that kind of thing. So we could look at that.
Thank you. Any other questions or discussions or comments on this? All right. All those in favor of granting the license to Eco ATM Kiosk located at Stop and Shop on King Street, please say aye.
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 Any opposed? Any abstentions? Okay. You can let them know, Pam. They're in San Jose. I'm sure they're jumping up and down right now. San Diego. Sorry. San Diego. Next up, and I would ask that you consider recognizing Terry Culhane, is the discussion for the private roadways that were for review with recommendations as noted below.
Motion to recognize Terry Culhane.
Second.
Terry, all those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. And now you can come up there, Terry. What we're discussing is we have four streets here, Center Court, Paquette Avenue, Park Avenue, and Hebert Avenue. All of them come without recommendation from the BPW, and three of them come without recommendation from the planning board, and the exception is Hebert Avenue, which has a split BPW with no recommendation, and we have a memo from the planning department, the planning board, because they offered a yes recommendation. Terry is here to speak to the non-recommendations for all four of these. Take it away, Terry.
We struggled actually a little bit with, it was clear how we would word a vote on our part to recommend that you accept the street. You know, we voted to recommend that the city council accept the street. We struggled a little bit with what to do when we didn't recommend. And the actual wording of the vote that we took in each case was that, in our opinion, X street did not meet what we felt were reasonable minimal criteria to become a city street. So we didn't actually return a no recommendation. We didn't
disrecommendation.
Yeah, we disrecommended, yeah, right. If you will. Do you want me to just talk about them one at a time? Or?
Would you please? And I actually have a note submitted by one of the residents on Center Court that I'll read after your presentation. But actually, maybe I'll read it now so that at least you're apprised of it and maybe address some of the concerns. This is from Floyd Andrus, who he's the owner of a four-unit building located at 1420 Center Court. I'm writing you in advance of tonight's City Council meeting to express my position regarding the acceptance of Center Court as a city street. And I encourage you not to follow the recommendation of the Board of Public Works and the Planning Department, and instead vote to make Center Street a city street. I've owned this historic property since March 1982. At that time, there were only a handful of residents who lived here, and most of Northampton had never heard of Center Court. Today, because of the encouragement and decisions made by the city with regard to some of the properties on Center Court, which is in the downtown business zoning district, and on the corner of 43 Center Street, Center Court is now more of an extension of the downtown business area than it is a small unknown neighborhood. With the growth of these new businesses and services and newly renovated housing units, there comes an increase in both resident and non-resident vehicular traffic, but more so foot traffic. These developments have created a vital need to maintain the street year-round for safety of those who live, work, and visit the businesses on Center Court. There is an active fire hydrant and public utilities on Center Court, which makes the access necessary and negates the BPW's contention that Center Court is merely a parking lot or driveway to individual residents. Over the years, the DPW has successfully plowed there's a number of counselors who've heard from some of the property owners there also historically about this issue. And it should be noted that there's ongoing issues and conflicts around Center Court about any number of reasons. So there you go.
It's undeniably a great little neighborhood in the middle of town. And I think all of the Board of Public Works people, members, appreciated that it's kind of a unique neighborhood. The challenge that we came up with that ultimately kept us from recommending acceptance is that it's really difficult to mark out clearly delineated, this is street, that's parking. If there's a snow emergency, you can get off of the street and have off-street parking. If you walk back there and just walk around kind of looking at it, trying to, okay, let's see, is that parking? Well, it's kind of street. So that was really the problem we came up with that ultimately resulted in not getting our support. We cannot see a clear, unambiguous, this is street, that's parking. It's more like the sort of place where you'd call the tenants out, they'd be shuffling cars, you'd be doing some plowing, move the cars back. To us, it seems more like a typical parking lot kind of arrangement. It's a tough call, and I'm sure that you'll find yourselves of two minds on it.
Are there any questions? Councilor O'Donnell.
Do you know if emergency vehicles can go down Center Court easily?
Our understanding is that the emergency vehicles the city has can go anywhere they want. Even if no one plows it, the fire department is confident that they can get in almost anywhere.
Okay, thank you.
Councilor Klein?
My concern about the Center Court is that if one of the problems is there's so much traffic there, and it's parking, mm-hmm. cars parked, that, first of all, that's testament to the fact that it's a very well-used street. People
sure.
coming and going. I know there are a lot of therapy offices and things like that there that people are, you know, parking for their appointments and utilizing the buildings in Center Court. It makes sense to me that we might want to think about, if it were in fact a city street, doing something about the parking situation and somehow regulating the parking situation so that it doesn't become a big parking lot. I think the fact that it is a parking lot is just testament to the fact that it's a well-used city street. So this is the one street that I do have concerns about it not, in fact, getting that recommendation.
Mm-hmm. Well, our recommendation, or lack thereof, is purely that. The decision is clearly with the City Council, always has been.
Let me clarify what the process is here tonight. We're going to accept or not the recommendations from these two boards. And should we run counter to, well, let's just say for Center Court, if we should decide that we will not accept their recommendations from the Planning Board and from the BPW, it goes back to the DPW to draft the documents that you're very familiar with at this point about street acceptance. So we will not be approving or disapproving essentially any street tonight, only the recommendations. So that's the process that we'll be going through tonight. So that's just for clarification, and believe me, I was pretty foggy on it too, so I'm just about to caught up. Any other questions relative to, let's say, Center Court, Councilor LaBarge, and then Councilor
Yes, I think, Jarrah. Councilor Dwight, if you can recall, way back, we had to do a site visit.
I've done three.
Yeah, when there was a problem with the owner from, it used to be the old Elks building, and we actually had the fire department go into that site, and they could go ahead and go in there.
Councilor Shara.
Would the owners be able to sort of delineate the parking, or is that something the city could do to sort of make those boundaries clear?
In my personal opinion, it doesn't lend itself to curbing. Mm-hmm. I'm sure they could do
because of the
lines.
Shape and the
yeah. They're, if you look at the picture there, they're really awkward, irregular shapes.
Right.
There are also, if you look where I think that's 19, there are two cars parked in front of number 19, and then there's a. You could almost imagine a circle of gray pavement mm-hmm. To the right of those two cars. That's a real low spot. There's a. Some bad drainage problems there. We've spoken with the owner of that house in the past about how that might be addressed. The owner was hoping the city might want to participate in that. And at the time, we declined, but there's some chronic drainage issues at that end of the lot. Mm-hmm. And there's some unusual utility issues going through there. Combination of public-private utility lines.
Councilor O'Donnell.
Thank you. On that point, this letter from Mr. Andrus, I think, references a fire hydrant, which is, I think, is back there by 19, and that's a public fire hydrant. Does that have any bearing on this question? I guess my question is, what do you make of the fact that the fire hydrant is there? Is that a relevant fact? In terms of
we have water lines and fire hydrants in other places that are not public streets.
Okay.
It doesn't by itself indicate, therefore, it's not a causal.
Right. So it's found elsewhere. Okay.
We would have to have an easement to have access. If it's not accepted as a city street, we would need to have an easement established for access to the, I think there's a water line under there. And and are those sewer lines ours, or is, no, they're not ours? And that was part of the contention, I guess. So they wanted us to assume some sewer line and retrofits to address the flooding. I just walked down there yesterday. And I looked, and to think when we did plow this, and maybe, and we might have to recognize Ned for this, but how did we plow it in the past? Mr. Andrus refers to the fact that the city has plowed it and, quote, maintained it, close quote. How do we affect those services in the past? And actually, would the council move to recognize Ned Huntley?
So moved.
Second.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Yeah, Ned, can you speak to this a little bit?
Sure. We have a small one-ton dump truck that will go in there, push all the way in, push snow around the big tree that's in there where the fire hydrant is, then plow itself back out.
Oh, and then you plow it out and remove it?
Right.
And then
the rest of it gets dumped onto Center Street.
Of it, and that the city is obliged to plow it and provide other services. I'm a little concerned that if we accept Center Court, then I don't, it's not saying that they would do that, but there are similar circumstances in this respect, and that's part of my concern. I think to Mr. Andrus's point, the criteria that he cited aren't necessarily criteria by which we do city streets. The fact that there are abutting properties and residents, we have that. Driveways do that as well. There's a number of streets that we are going to reject, and probably in some cases tonight, that also have houses abutting them, and in some cases businesses. This is sticky. It's amorphous and ambiguous, and it changes all the time. But I'm concerned about your concerns, and I'd like to know more about what your concerns are beyond having difficulty delineating and possibly navigating cars in the parking situation. What is the downside for the city accepting this as a city street?
I guess the first downside would be the drainage issues that exist inside that area. I know discussions with one of the property owners had actually gotten a cost estimate to run a drain line in from Center Street into the low-lying area to drain that out. The rest of it past building number 9 and 6 flows down into the James House parking lot. So they kind of, it's just kind of on a hillside, so it moves away. So that was my first concern with any kind of additional utility put out there. The 4-inch water line was put in by the city water department a number of years ago. We do technically own it. I'd be more than happy to take an easement for it in the future to maintain and replace as necessary and so on. The sewer services were created at the turn of the century by a private person, and I know that building 19 had some sewer issues of late there, and they had to actually put in a pump station to get their sewage out of their building. So I don't really want to own those sewer utilities in there either. I think they'd become an expense to the city at some point. But as far as similarities to other private ways, they are similar to some degree, except most of them don't end into a very large pavement area where there's a lot of parking. Most of them have driveways off of them, like regular city streets. Most of the private ways we did go look at.
Okay. Any other questions relative to Center Court? We have a few others to go here, but.
I'm just going to recuse myself on this because my father is the happy owner of number 6.
Okay. So in Center Court.
I'm very familiar with it, but I'm not going to comment.
Council Murphy just dodged a bullet.
The other issue that Terry talked about was, you know, the width of it. Let's say we do a 15-foot layout or a minimum 20-foot wide layout, and we want to have no parking on it. How are we going to sign it and post it accordingly when there's no curbing? If you put in curbing, that's going to create even bigger drainage issues internal to there. And then when we do a snow emergency, where are they parking their cars from in there? They're going to have to be off somewhere, so they could. They might still be in the layout of the roadway. There is no green belt that they can go beyond and be outside of it. It's just pavement.
Can I ask a question with regard to that? So in the past, when there have been snow emergencies and plowing has taken place, what has been, I mean, you said you haven't plowed yourself there, but I'm just curious, they must be getting the cars off the street.
I don't know offhand. If there's been tickets and tows up there, I really don't know.
We've been ticketing private streets, that private ways, that'd be...
This actually started a couple of years ago on Edward Square. This is what brought this whole thing to fruition.
That's right. That's right. That's how we got to where we are today.
That's correct.
Ticketing a private way for snow plowing, snow emergencies, and it was contested. Terry, you want to continue with your presentation? So now we have Paquette Avenue. Can you get Paquette?
Hell.
Floyd Andrus. She's just to be recognized.
Move to recognize Floyd Andrus.
There's a motion to accept Floyd allow Floyd Andrus to speak. Is there a second?
Second.
Second it.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Mr. Andrus?
Thank you. My name is Floyd Andrus. I live at 81 Lake Street in Florence. And by the discussion, I can see that you all got that email. I might talk a little funny. I had a wisdom tooth removed, and it was pretty unpleasant. So if
Red,
I sound a little different, then please excuse me. Center Court has its problems, like most of the streets in Northampton. It is a private way. It's been plowed by the city ever since I owned it in 82, and it's been taken care of. It's quite interesting because there was more of a parking problem on Center Court back then there is now. We manage that. The people that are there manage that very well. There are five owners of the buildings, five buildings, we take care of that situation as far as the parking goes ourselves now. In the past, when Iron Horse was in, and they would just flood the street. The Elks, when they were open, it was a major problem in parking. It's managed better now. We do have problems on the street. There is no question about it. It's a short street. As Mr. Culain had said that the buildings are right up to the street, or right up to the entryways going in. Signs could be put on the buildings indicating that it is a street. If it is a street, then we have, as owners of our properties, a little more leeway, or a lot of leeway, as to keep that open for emergency vehicles and for any maintenance that is required. The street in itself has a right-of-way, and the right-of-way is about 17 feet wide at its closest point, and it goes out into 28 feet around the tree. That, by and large, has been left open for people that are there to get in and out without having to back up. That's worked well. Lily Gave, that owns two buildings there, tells all of her therapists. And refused to leave. On occasions, the police department has come over and has straightened out some situations. There is a hydrant there that needs access at all times. And we take care of that now. During this past winter, when we had to plow, it was managed very well. The only people that park there right now are the tenants that are there, and occasionally someone will come in to drop something off. But if you have any questions, I'd be happy to answer them for you.
Councilor Klein?
Mr. Andrus, do you know approximately how many are actual residential units versus office units?
Yes, there are some condominiums right now, and I believe that there's four condominium units that was just renovated by Roger Salone. The only other apartments there are the ones that I have, and there is two apartments on the second floor. On the first floor is law offices.
So there are six full-time residential units on the whole street, and that's it?
Yes.
The rest are offices by day, and at night are people are leaving?
I mean, it's business, yes. Which, incidentally, gets a lot of traffic. This is a therapist, and also the law office that's down there. This is hourly stuff. This isn't long-term. Somebody goes in, parks, and stays there.
And do you know if the six residential units have off-street parking associated with them?
We have access to the parking lot that is over at the James House that is directly in back. And there is additional parking over there. When it snows, the tenants move over there. Business people move over. So as far as getting it plowed and getting it maintained, that's not the problem.
Councilor Spector?
Just a question. The businesses that are there, the therapist that's there, the lawyers, if the street became a public way, what is their feeling about that? Because then they wouldn't control the parking in front anymore.
I didn't hear your entire question.
Those folks who have businesses there now.
Yes.
My understanding is there's parking in front of the therapist's office. Is that correct?
Yes, there is parking. Right.
Okay, so I'm just curious as to how, what their reaction is, because if you became a public way, they would no longer have control over that parking. In other words, their clients right now can pull up right in front of the lawyer's office, the therapist's office. If it became a public way, I might park there, you know, or yes. people might park there. And yes. I'm just wondering what their sense was who own a business there, where right now they basically kind of have control of that parking, which is pretty valuable.
Yes. On the right-of-way, everybody honors that. They go off the right-of-way to park. And I mean, suggested to Mr. Huntley that the easiest solution would be to have the street to be the right-of-way, or the right-of-way to be the street. The outline is there. Now, the engineering is done on that. It works now. When, I mean, people park, they park off of that right-of-way. So other people can get in and move around.
I understand that part, but I'm just curious if I had a business there, and right now when my yes. client comes, they have a parking space right there, correct?
Yes.
Because it's basically used as almost like a private, it is private, so therefore someone can park in that space. Would that space still be available if it was a public way? Is the parking for those businesses affected if that street became a public way and they'd become part public parking?
Well, yeah, that is now, they would be able to park and I mean, the street would be open. So it's actually, if it's a street, then if everybody parks there, there is no parking. People do go in there now and they do park in those spaces. Sometimes they're asked to leave, but other times it works out. If they're dropping something off, it's a short time.
Councilor Sharon?
The spaces that you're referring to, are those within the property lines of that building? Or
yes.
Because I think what Councilor Spector is asking, if those became public and let's say we metered them, how would the owners of those buildings feel about that?
Well, on the right of way, the other land would be private. If the right of way goes in and it goes around, then there, I mean, there's no parking other than onto private property.
Oh, so you're saying what the parking that's there now is within the bounds of the
yes,
property?
Right. I have a copy of this if anyone would like to look at it.
Do you have a neighborhood association?
We have had in the past. We have gotten together. We have not gotten together. I mean, recently there, people. I've been gone. I've had some health issues, but we do get along and we do talk most of the time.
For instance, when you commission a plower, I'm sure you don't have. For every property owner, there's a different plower that's coming in to plow. You collectively agree to hire somebody, and that
yes.
And the same thing, as you said, when people come and park on essentially private property, your frustration is that the city can't enforce that. But point in fact, you can, because these people are essentially trespassing and parking without permission, and you can call a tow service, have the car towed. They just
yes.
won't get a ticket, but they'll have to pay for the towing and stuff, particularly if you post it. So it seems to me that your principal desire is for plowing and some maintenance, but at the same time, there's a lot, and I think this Councilor Spector alluded to, there's a lot you give up when it becomes a public street. When it becomes a public way,
yes.
then you lose control as to who can and cannot park there in certain circumstances, depending on how we delineate the street, which in some cases, as I look at that parking lot, will cut across what people understand as their parking spaces.
Yes.
This speaks largely to the problem that Mr. Culhane was describing. It's assuming a great responsibility on the city, at the same time limiting your control of I haven't heard from, I've spoken with Mr. Saloom and in the past with Lily Gave and others about this issue, and I haven't heard how people would feel if this suddenly came under the aegis of the city and all the restrictions and limitations that a city street would have. I've only heard what the benefits would be, but these limitations are substantial, and the changes and impact on the property owners, the abutting property owners, would be significant ultimately. And the other challenge is, of course, if we did take the right-of-way as you described, that right-of-way does cut across diagonally in some of those parking spaces, the way that they're, at least what I saw, and I was basing the right-of-way assumption from there has been some dig out for some of the
yes.
waterline access.
Yes.
So, I mean, this is what we're wrestling with right now as well. So I just want to, I want you to be clear that there are consequences to, should we change and go against these recommendations, there are probably some unintended consequences that might not be considered ideal by the abutters.
But there is no parking, I mean, on the city streets. I mean, you can't park, I mean, on a city street.
Right on the street.
We park into designated parking places. In use of city property. That is wide enough, it's big enough now, so people get in and out. And yeah, the posting of it, it can be marked. It's blacktop at presently. It can be marked. The other option could be that it could be a fire lane, and it could be marked as a fire lane, and that would restrict anyone from parking right where access is needed. There has been a major fire that was in one of the buildings not too many years ago that could have been catastrophic. It was 2:00 in the morning, and if it was during a time when that street could not have been accessed, it would have been a major disaster. This is what we're trying to avoid. You see, the entire center court, that whole area behind the buildings, is all fenced in.
Right.
So it's a box canyon. And that alone in itself speaks volumes. So this is a safety issue, as much as it is getting a drainage in and getting sewers and so on. There was a catch basin there, but environmentally it was covered over, taken out. So now it runs in between my building and my neighbor's building. We have designed the blacktop so the water runs into the parking lot over at the James Building.
Councilor Klein had a question.
I actually have a follow-up question for Mr. Culhane and possibly Mr. Huntley, if possible.
Yeah. So thank you, Mr. Andrews.
Okay.
It's a kind of a follow-up question. I think I heard Mr. Huntley say that the drainage, a lot goes into the James House parking lot. So I'm just wondering about kind of liability for the city or issues for the city, costs for the city from problems that they're having if it remains a private way. If all of the, whatever it is, the runoff is going into city property, is that an issue, something that we need to be thinking about?
It's not an ideal we're talking about stormwater here. It's not an ideal setup. Downhill is in the direction of the going up on the screen toward all the parked cars. That's downhill in actuality.
And that's the James House parking lot?
Yeah.
So that if they, if
you were to
engineer
a really solid, proper solution, it would be an underground culvert taking stormwater to the storm drains on Center Court, probably.
And that would be up to the owners to take care of, so that if it's not taken care of by the, if it remains a private way, it's not taken care of by the owners, there could be issues for the city in terms of all of this runoff that's coming into city property.
The homeowners might incur some liability. It's all hypothetical, but.
Councilor O'Donnell?
Thanks. Question for you, Mr. Culhane. It seems like this is a sprawling discussion, but it actually boils down to where the individual property lines are and where's the private way, and whether you can have actual curbs that distinguish private from public. That's what I'm hearing in terms of snow plowing. And I think you touched on that in your initial comments. So my question is there kind of a list of things that if they were done, maybe by the current private owners, it would suddenly make it acceptable to you and the Board of Public Works and the Department of Public Works to accept as a street, the conditions that could be met?
That's a good question. Ned will attest to the fact that I have pestered him for the past year about this. I mean, this is a fairly compelling property. This is not a property where it was fun for us to say that we did not recommend acceptance. And I was have pestered Ned in the past about, come on, let's go over there and figure out what would have to happen for this to be a more appetizing public street. And I believe you've done it too. You wind up looking around, and it's just a little hard to figure out a clean, unambiguously successful solution.
Just as a quick follow-up, if more head scratching and kind of pacing around were done and a solution were arrived at, this could be revisited in the future, I imagine.
Absolutely.
Okay.
At the council's initiative.
Councilor Spector.
Yeah, I just wanted to attest to the fact that you and the group that was looking at all these streets, I watched you from the beginning become more and more open to accepting streets, really leaning towards accepting any street that could be accepted and looking for those reasons and trying not to reject streets. But I also appreciate the fact that you have a certain criteria. And though this particular street seems to be the hardest one for us to decide, the fact that both your group and the planning board both spent a lot, I know both spent a lot of time on this and came up with the decision to not
lines and that is not an issue because it is on the deeds, and you should not have a problem if you're out there with the surveyors, you know where the property lines are, correct?
Yeah.
Okay.
Any other questions on Center Court?
Nope.
That's the first one.
Okay, next one in the list is Paquette Avenue.
Right.
And this is coming up right now. The salient issue about Paquette Avenue that persuaded the Board of Public Works to not suggest accepting the street is that the entire property is owned by one owner. It's a trust, but the entire property is owned by one owner. So you see the four buildings right by 16 there? Mm-hmm. That's one owner. They're apartments. They're rental units. They own the street. They own the apartments. It's entirely one piece of private property. And the BPW is persuaded that this was didn't feel like a street. It looks more like an apartment complex.
Is there a name to that complex itself? Is there a, just out of curiosity?
No. What was the, who was it? Jerry? Jerry Wallace, who lived, he had his office at 138. He was an accountant, wound up owning that property, and he's passed away, but his heirs own it in the form of a trust.
And it's not named in some way with a sign as you come in?
No.
Okay.
I think those might have been, was that mill housing?
It does have a sign.
Oh, it does?
Do you know what it's called, Ned?
But it's not like River Run or something.
I could see on Google Earth, there might be a zoom down.
Was that mill housing?
I mean, because that would make a difference.
In any event, that, as far as the BPW is concerned, that was a salient point that led to us deciding not to recommend it.
Why doesn't co-housing with 32 buildings?
And you've heard from any petitioners on the street about their desire to have it become a
city? At the public hearing, the owner of the trust, actually there was a brother and a sister there, they would have been happy to see it to begin to receive plowing services.
So, but they were the only ones who spoke in favor, not necessarily the residents or their tenants? Or
no, we didn't hear from any residents.
Yeah, I think if we were to accept this as a public way, we'd have a number of other places, including, I can think of off the top of my head, and two of the co-housing, which have longer roadway, and it looks just like a road, going to their place with even more units. If I lived there, I would say, well, if you made this a public way, why aren't you going to make our place a public way? We'd have a number of others like that.
The co-housing roads were actually built to our specifications.
Yes. And I'm sure there are other places like that. So,
any other questions relative to Paquette? Park Avenue.
Okay, Park Avenue, I'm afraid, is another parking lot issue. Mm-hmm. It's like a lollipop. It's a parking lot on a stick. So once this gets blown up a little bit. So where it says Park Avenue, you see there's a tall rectangle there. Mm-hmm. And there is in the historical records, that was a layout for a street at one point, although at that time it just went to one house. There's no evidence that the city ever considered it a street, but it was laid out as if it were a street. And over the years, the parking lot has grown further up and to the left. And that's all those have become condos at this point. Once the plow gets to the end of that tall rectangle, it wasn't at all clear what would happen next. And ultimately the board felt that this was another example of a somewhat amorphous parking lot and no clear right-of-way.
Again, the petitioners were all the abutting residents?
They were, and they were universally in favor of it becoming a street and getting the plowing services.
And the systems, any services under the street that require a right-of-way? Nothing? Councilor Klein?
Is there any public parking, per se, on Park Avenue? I mean, are there spaces that are not, somehow owned by the different buildings and residences?
No, I mean, there would be no reason to go down there if you didn't live there or weren't visiting somebody. It doesn't feel like, oh, this is a public space when you go back there. It feels like you're in someone's driveway.
Any other discussion on Park Avenue? Now, this is the next one up is Hebert Avenue. And once again, this comes with a disrecommendation, if you will, a word we will make up and coin. From the BPW, negative recommendation.
Yep.
Thank you. That works too. And with a positive recommendation, however, from planning, and I have a memo to that effect from Carolyn Mish. This is in response to Councilor LaBarge's query, but it says, Councilor LaBarge, I understand you had questions about the planning board discussion related to these streets that are up for a vote on public acceptance. The planning board voted to have no recommendation on these streets for a couple of different reasons. As it relates to Center Court, Paquette, and Park, the board had lengthy discussions about how these three essentially exist and function as private parking lots. The board determined that these don't really function as streets and that it really boiled down to a political issue about whether the city should create slash accept slash maintain parking lots and alleys as public spaces or in the urban core. In terms of Hebert, the board felt this functioned like a private driveway, and again, it felt that it was a political policy decision, not a planning decision about whether these types of access ways should be publicly maintained. So she doesn't really clarify as to what the disparity was, the discrepancy was.
Well, we, but if you could nudge the picture down a little further.
Slide down this way, Pam, so you can reveal more of it.
Okay.
Yeah.
So what's interesting about this is you can see the curve of Hebert Avenue goes right into that grassy curve that then curves to the right. It's a lovely, or potentially a lovely spot down there along the river. Leading up toward the Smith College physical plant, mm-hmm. And access to the bridge over the river on the bike path. So my understanding is the planning department has been intrigued at the possibilities of getting access to the bike path and the river along this route. Having said that, the residents are cognizant of that, and to the contrary, they would really prefer that people were not coming up and down the street and accessing the river and the bike path through their yards.
So the residents were not in favor of it being a
based
public
on the fact
way,
that they would prefer that it not become an access point.
So they would like it to be a public way.
Did a study for us. The engineering program did a study about trying to create a spur to the bike path. And it was at that point when I was Ward 4 counselor that I held a very interesting meeting with all the residents about the prospects of that, and got the same response that Mr. Culhane has relayed this evening, that there was not an interest in that becoming, that there be any public access to it. The city does have public access to it because we're guaranteed access to the dike system.
And correct. I think the electric company.
The electric company also has access. So we do have a right of way to get down there to get to our systems that are down there. But that was one of the issues.
The concern of people on Hebert is people parking their cars and then accessing the bike path or walking path from there.
There's a number of issues. There's issues related to some seasonal camping that's occurred down there in the past, dog neighborhood dog walking, lots of other sorts of activities.
So if the city.
So just a question of a.
Councilor Klein actually had the floor. Before,
okay.
But then you, yes. Councilor Spector, Councilor.
So just to follow up on. If the city does have access and the electric department does have access, but we wouldn't be plowing and we would be dependent on the residents to actually plow, how does that match up? What if we needed access for some reason as a city?
Well, again, my understanding is emergency vehicles and the kind of big trucks that need to get into places like this can pretty much go there at will. It's unlikely there would be so much snow that a big truck couldn't go wherever it needed to go.
So even if for some reason the residents didn't plow...
Which would be hard to imagine, but that's my understanding. Or maybe someone from the DPW comes over to facilitate the... In fairness to the people on Hebert Avenue, the house number 17 there, the path does go right next to his house. And it's a lovely, quiet little enclave. It's depressed down below South Street. It doesn't show clearly in the picture here, but it's down below and out of the way. And
so, Terry, I'm a little confused. If the residents on a private way are not asking it to be a public way, do we even have the authority to say, we're going to turn your private way, which you are not asking to become public, into a public way?
Perhaps not.
No one is petitioning, because usually you have to petition.
And I think someone did petition.
Oh, okay. Someone did petition.
So, basically, city residents made the petition, but no one from this neighborhood made the petition. It was a street that we are historically plowing. We do have water and stormwater drains in the street, which are intended to take easements for that we currently do not have, and they're aware that we're looking to do that. They just didn't want the general public being down there. That's what they voiced at the public hearing.
So anyone can petition that a street become a public way, even if it's a private way that has certain rights of way or not. What authority do the residents or power do the residents on that street, the owners on that street, have if they don't want it to become a public way?
They voiced at the public hearing.
Okay. This may help clear it up. We were concerned that we needed to get this process moving. And finally, Alan Seawalt pounded it into our heads that the proper process was for a petition to be sent to the city council and for the city council to then refer it to us and for us to, after that point, call a public hearing. In an effort to streamline this whole thing and to have these streets showing up in an orderly manner, we began generating petitions signed by people who were just walking through the Department of Public Works. Gotcha. So we actually created the petition. None of them were even aware of it. But it was a mechanism to start so we could do six or seven streets a month.
Okay.
Any more questions on Hebert? All right, that's the lot. Okay. That's a lot. I said I'd get you out by 8. I lied.
Close enough.
I'm sorry. Now it's incumbent upon us, and I would like to take these one street at a time for acceptance, given the fact that there's probably some struggling with some of these. So I'd accept a motion on Center Court to accept the recommendations from the Planning Board and from the BPW.
So moved.
Second. Or second. Now, discussion. And let me just say that if we accept these recommendations, that's the end of this process, so that there will be no further advancement towards, at least at this time, making this a public way.
Just clarify, acceptance of the recommendation means that it will not be a public street.
Right. It will not be what? Exactly. Will not be a public street.
Will not be a public street.
Right. Councilor Shara.
And so if we don't accept it, then it moves forward, a petition moves forward, which
then
we would then need to vote on.
Refer it back to the Department of Public Works, and they'll draft up an order similar to what you've seen, along with the city solicitor, along with takings, and all the language that you've seen that delineates where the road is and isn't, and then it'll come before us to vote up or down.
Will it continue to be plowed this winter?
It will be continued to be plowed until such time that we determine it will not be a public way, and that would, if that occurs tonight, it will not be plowed. And Ned, is it being plowed now?
Last year, this was one of the ways that was not plowed by Public Works because of the no recommendation.
Okay. So it will, it, it, And even if we advance this, it still won't be plowed, it won't be available for plowing until it's accepted as a city street. Councilor Sher.
So some of the work we talked about tonight about trying to delineate where curbs would go, that would happen at this next stage if we try and figure out whether that's even possible.
I'll be corrected if I'm wrong, is that if we do advance this, it's incumbent upon the DPW to actually determine what actually is the city street and make those, and then identify that with identifiers and markers. And it doesn't mean installing curbing right away or any of that stuff. It just means that they will have to distinguish what essentially will be the area of taking.
So after that sort of exploration, it could maybe be determined that it's not feasible.
I'm hearing from them that that isn't, but that's Councilor's back.
Well, I just want to say, I don't think by our saying, please explore this more, the DPW, that we're going to come up with a different answer. We, you know, they'll have to come up with something, but what we're hearing from them is we don't know how to make this a public way. We've looked, we've wanted to, and we can't see a solution to that. I think what we were looking at before was the possibility of not accepting it now, and if somebody else wants to take a look at this down the road.
So a yes means it will not become a city street. A no means it will start the process, too.
Thank you.
Center Court first, yes. This is to Center Court.
Councilor Carney.
Yes.
Councilor Dwight.
Yes.
Councilor Klein.
No.
Councilor LaBarge.
No.
Councilor Murphy.
I'm staying.
Councilor O'Donnell.
Yes.
Councilor Shara.
No.
Councilor Spector.
Yes.
Councilor Adams.
No.
We have a tie vote on acceptance.
Recommendation. Recommendation
no.
fails.
That means no.
Yeah, the recommendation fails, or the acceptance of the recommendation fails, and we will be revisiting this.
The noes have it.
Essentially, the noes have it.
The noes have it.
Because a yes is no.
So this will be referred back to the Department of Public Works to draft up an order for further debate and discussion. Okay, next up, Paquette Avenue. This, again, this is with no recommendation from either the BPW or the planning. I'll accept a motion to accept referrals.
So moved.
Second.
Thank you so much. Any debate on Paquette? Any discussion questions? Okay. I'm going to ask for a roll call on this one as well.
Councilor Dwight.
Yes.
Councilor Klein.
Yes.
Councilor LaBarge.
Yes.
Councilor Murphy.
Yes.
Councilor O'Donnell.
Yes.
Councilor Shara.
Yes.
Councilor Spector.
Yes.
Councilor Adams.
Yes.
Councilor Carney.
Yes.
All right. Those recommendations are accepted unanimously. Next up is Park Avenue. Accept the motion.
So moved.
Second.
Any further discussion on Park Avenue? Roll call, please.
Counselor Klein.
Yes.
Counselor LaBarge.
Yes.
Counselor Murphy.
I will abstain on this one, too.
Counselor O'Donnell.
Yes.
Counselor Shara.
Yes.
Counselor Spector.
Yes.
Counselor Adams.
Yes.
Counselor Carney.
Yes.
And last but not least, Ebert Avenue. I'll accept the motion.
Second it.
What?
Oh, I thought he said that.
This is a motion to accept the BPWs?
Remind us what the recommendation was.
Actually, now we have to separate the recommendations at point. So first recommendation is to accept the recommendation from the BPW, and I'll accept a motion on that.
Motion on that.
Second.
Okay, and for the purpose of the discussion, once again, accepting this recommendation means that they will not go any further. We're going to come up to a vote on the recommendation from planning, which runs counter to this. So, roll call, please. Who seconded that? Counselor O'Donnell made it. Counselor Spector and the Counselor.
She made it.
Okay.
Marianne LaBarge made it in one of these.
Got it.
I got it.
Got it. Okay. All right. I tried to second. Any further discussion on the recommendation from the Board of Public Works? Or the non-recommendation, negative recommendation from the Board of Public Works. Roll call, please.
Counselor LaBarge.
Yes.
Counselor Murphy.
Yes.
Counselor O'Donnell.
Yes.
Counselor Shara.
Yes.
Counselor Spector.
Yes.
Counselor Adams.
Yes.
Counselor Carney.
Yes.
Counselor Dwight.
Yes.
Counselor Klein.
Yes.
Okay, well, that vote presages what the next vote's going to be. I'll accept it. But it's... But it wasn't given, so that's why we split it. So I'll accept a motion.
I move to accept the recommendation of the planning board.
Okay. Is there a second?
Second.
Okay. Now, in this case, a yes vote means that
you accept
we're stuck in the
we have a recommendation on this street. I don't know why we need to take this vote.
Yeah. Why are we taking this?
It doesn't make sense.
No, I'm just saying this.
I think it's important to take it, just for the record, because it's split out.
There's no reason.
There are two boards made recommendations, Board of Public Works and Planning Board, and we have to act on each.
So you want to split?
Could I withdraw my second so it just
There's
fails?
No second, it will fail.
I'll second.
You can't second, you made the motion.
Oh.
So could I withdraw my second so there is, I withdraw it.
Just sparing us a vote.
What we don't know, is anyone seconding the Okay,
yeah,
thank you.
Let's go. Okay.
Just do it.
Let's put it this way. A yes vote means we're in hell.
No vote means we move on.
No vote means that our brains don't explode.
Okay.
We made the vote here, but that was just so. Roll call, please.
Counselor LaBarge.
No.
Counselor
No.
Counselor O'Donnell.
No.
Counselor Shara.
No.
Counselor Spector.
No.
Counselor Adams.
No.
Counselor Carney.
No.
Counselor Dwight.
No.
Counselor Klein.
No.
Okay. So our brains remain intact after a fashion. So as it stands, Center Court will be referred back to the Department of Public Works. The others have failed and will not be qualified or considered for public streets. Next up is approval of the council minutes from your laudable meeting last time.
Move to approve.
Excuse me, do you need me here for the second readings for the other public tonight?
We're counselors, we're coming up
no.
to the
second readings.
Do we need Ned here to discuss any further on the streets acceptances on second reading?
The minutes.
Motions have been second. Minutes and seconded. Are there any amendments, Councilor Shara?
One quick amendment under the park space for the zoning for BNC. It should also say 300 square feet or 30 square feet per unit, whichever is larger. It just says 30 right now.
With those amendments?
Just in those
amendments, yeah.
So can you write out that amendment for Pam?
It's correct in the ordinance. It's just not correct in the minutes.
So to replicate what it's reflected in the ordinance, so Scribner's error. Mm-hmm. So that
accepted.
Amendment's made and accepted. Okay. Any further discussion on the minutes?
How do you know it's correct in the ordinance?
Because It's in the ordinance.
It's in there, okay.
Because I...
It's in the minutes.
Right.
Got it. Checks and balances.
So the motion's been made as amended.
To accept the minutes.
To accept the minutes and seconded. Any further discussion on the minutes? All those in favor, please say aye.
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 Any opposed? I will be abstaining. Any other abstentions? Okay. Reports of committees and appointments and elections, none. Now this is our regular time where we recess for finance, and where I cede the gavel to Councilor Murphy.
For that, whereas Almer Bud Huntley Jr. has offered to donate 2 granite Boston and Maine Railroad mileage markers that were originally installed along the railroad tracks, and whereas the city's Bicycle and Pedestrian Advisory Committee supports reinstalling these makers along the Northampton Rail Trail, now therefore it be ordered the City of Northampton, acting through its Office of Planning and Sustainability and Department of Public Works, is authorized to accept the rocks. Somebody want to
send it forward with a positive recommendation?
Positive. And second?
Second.
Anybody want to talk about the rocks? Anybody have questions for Mr. Fiden about the rocks?
Just a quick question. Is the Bud Huntley of the...
That's Mr. Huntley's father.
Okay, thank you. I should. Thank you.
Councilor Barge?
On these granite-type stones that they use... Why could we recognize Wayne, please?
He's recognized from before, I think.
Yes, Wayne. Okay, they were put in by the surveying crew. Then when they came in to start the railroad section up there, why did they remove them?
I think they just weren't needed. I don't know the history well enough. Bud was doing some work on surveying, and they didn't need them, and he worked out a deal, and they sold it to him. They gave it to him.
And now they're going back.
They're going back to a different location.
Okay.
So I think, you know, there was an error, which we all know, in the 50s and 60s and 70s, where people didn't value historical features the way we do now.
Yeah, because that's way back.
Yes.
So if a 150-year-old surveyor comes back, he's going to be very confused.
Exactly.
Is there going to be moving?
I think so. Thank you, Wade.
So any more discussion on this one? All in favor, please say aye.
Hi.
Hi. Anyone opposed? And the next one is a Mr. Fiden one as well. Order that whereas the Open Space and Recreation Multi-Use Plan recommends preserving farmland in the meadows and improving public access to the meadows, and whereas Peter Bay offered to sell a parcel of prime farmland in the meadows on the south side of Hunts Road between Kings Highway and Walnut Tree Road, totaling 7 acres, and whereas this acquisition will help allow the land to be remaining in active agriculture and production, and whereas this acquisition has the potential to be used to trade to land to either preserve other farmland or to help provide public access to Rainbow Beach on the Connecticut River, and whereas funds will be drawn from the CPA conservation grants and community donations, and no additional appropriation is required for this purpose, therefore be ordered that the city is authorized to accept the property for for use and for trade, and the city's conservation commission is authorized to transfer this land to a private owner for use as farmland, either in return for land which could provide access to Rainbow Beach, or in return for agricultural preservation restrictions or conservation restrictions on other land in the meadows, or in return for funding at least equal to the purchase price of the land. Further, the Conservation Commission is authorized to retain an agricultural preservation restriction, or conservation restriction as defined by Mass General Law, Section 184, Section 31, on this land prior to transferring it out, and in said restriction hereby is accepted. The Conservation Commission is authorized to purchase or otherwise acquire for conservation and passive recreation purposes as provided under Section 8C of Chapter 40 of the General Laws and Community Preservation Act and Article 97 of the Amendments to the Massachusetts Constitution. Any fee, easement, or agricultural restriction as defined under Section 31 of Chapter 184 of the General Laws, or any other interest in land that provides access to Rainbow Beach and immediately adjoining land, and the City Council hereby accepts such restriction, and that the Conservation Commission is authorized to grant agriculture or conservation restrictions on any land so required. Sorry about my cold, but I hope you could understand that. Do we have a positive recommendation?
I wanted to recommend.
Just to get it on the floor.
Move.
Second.
Second. Okay. And Councilor Barge,
recognize.
You have a question for Mr. Fine?
Yes. Wayne, how much is it costing per acre?
I have to do the math. 3,400, 3,500, I believe.
How much?
I believe it's 3,500. Maybe it's 4,500. Do the math there.
I think this is great. And I think the accessing into the Rainbow Beach, we've talked about this ever since we wanted to get the other property. And I think we're preserving this farmland, and I think it also will encourage the public access, which we've talked about several years ago, hopefully to get property where we got it. And also the funds are coming or being drawn from the CPA, and also with funds and grants, can you talk to me a little bit about the fundraising or donations possibly and how you get those?
So we have some donations already, sort of in a revolving fund, the land that comes in. So we have cash on hand to buy this property from past donations that we have already.
And how do you get those donations? Do you send out to people?
Yeah, different causes. We have a lot of partners who help do fundraising with us. We've done some fundraising directly. We have some people who say, please approach us if you have a large acquisition.
I think it's great that the public hears that, because I think it's great that we have people who actually donate and help us preserve farmland like this, which is very valuable. Thank you for your hard work.
Thanks.
Thank you for going forward with finding this solution, because I know it's been a real issue for many people who have tried to walk their way to Rainbow Beach, and it's a significant hike. It's a good, from the edge of the airport, probably a 2 mile each way walk. But I think very important that there be some access other than just boat. I think for the past however many years, since that road had been blocked off, even though there was a trailhead and it was the Silvio Conti Riverine Research Area, a part of that, and I believe there's still the protected beetle down there.
There is.
So there are a number of considerations that the public would need to be very careful and treat that area respectfully and carefully. I really appreciate that there may be still a way for the public to access an incredible jewel down there on the riverway, on the Greenway, which is one of the, it's part of the National Park System.
It's a blue way, so it's a nationally recognized blue way.
Okay, thank you.
I just want to stress one thing so it's clear. So this is not, so we have an option to buy this property.
Still need to.
Which they're holding, right? So it may or may not ever work in terms of the trade land. Right. This property we think is an extremely reasonable price.
Yep.
But if you look at comparable sales, the reason this land is selling for a lot less than other farmland, it is wetter than most other farmlands. So it's 7 acres, it's probably only about 4 or 5 acres, which is farmable, which is great. Still gives us swap land, but I just want you to understand. If you talk to a farmer, this number seems low, it's because it is a wet piece.
Yeah, I'm worried.
Okay. Councilor Klein, you had a question, right?
With purchase of this land, what
beach and something were to go wrong, I mean, it creates a some level of liability.
So we have no legal liability. We don't want people to get hurt in our property. But from a legal liability standpoint, we don't have anything. It's called the recreation liability statute, which says if we're not charging for people coming on our property, we're not creating something active like a pool, we're not responsible if someone gets hurt. So there's no legal liability. Obviously, we do everything we can to make sure the trails are flat and trails are safe, and access there as safe as we can.
Councilor Carney.
So it's, to be understood, too, it's not really a beach in the traditional sense of a beach. I think it's just been known as that over the couple of centuries, that it's because there happens to be a strand of sand in that area, of a sandy area that's elevated up, that has mussel beds and things like that. But even though boaters have used it as a kind of a recreational beach area, it's not even really the beach in the sense that the Musanti Beach is. It's really just kind of a level, kind of raised part of the river that's higher, a higher level of sand.
The sand comes and goes in different years, so sometimes it's a, you know, a very long gradual beach, sometimes it's shorter and more eroded. But yeah.
Any other questions in finance? All right, then in finance, all in favor of a positive recommendation, please say aye.
Yes.
Aye.
Any opposed?
Great.
All right. The next one is upon the recommendation of Mayor David Narkowitz and the Conservation Commission. Order that whereas the Open Space and Recreation Multi-Use Plan that we just talked about recommends project protecting open space adjacent to the historic Mill River, and whereas the city is reducing property tax is reducing properties in tax title, including those parcels for which it is highly unlikely any taxes will ever be paid. And whereas David Golash and the Golash family has agreed to donate two parcels with negligible value, totaling 1.5 acres on the historic Mill River, to the city in a deed in lieu of foreclosure. And whereas the U.S. Fishery and Wildlife Service is interested in acquiring the parcels to add to the existing Conte Fish and Wildlife Refuge, and whereas the city is interested in acquiring the parcels adjacent to the historic Mill River and the city's Hockenham Road flood control structure, now therefore it be ordered that the city authorizes the mayor to accept the lieu of foreclosure for the above parcels for general government purposes, and further that the mayor is authorized to deed the parcel adjacent to the Conte Fish and Wildlife Service to the U.S. government for no consideration. Do we have a motion?
Motion.
Second?
Second.
Okay. Discussion? Do you all know where this is? This is kind of between the wastewater treatment plant and down by 91. In fact, were they? Mm-hmm. This is where they were camping, correct, Mr. Biden? There was several homeless camps down there at one point in time, and this kind of cleans that up because it was somebody's property, but they weren't involved in controlling or maintaining it, and it was kind of an awkward situation. So now, if it's city property or if it's federal property, the camping misbehavior can't really happen down there anymore. And we don't have to keep track of it for tax purposes. This was sort of orphaned by the building of 91. You know, they took most of it, but this little piece is left. Any questions for Mr. Feigen on this one?
No, I'd like to recognize the mayor also.
He's still recognized.
Thank you, Mayor. I'm a little confused about this. On the tax titles, how much tax title are they not paying on this?
Actually, I'm going to ask to go through the details of that, if you don't mind. He's been more close.
Because it doesn't say on it.
So I don't know the numbers offhand. The numbers themselves are tiny. It's a very small amount. The amount of years is very large. So this property really has no value at all. And so their tax bill is literally something like $10 or $20 a year.
Okay.
But it's been going on for 20 years, so it goes on for a long time. So Council Murphy's correct in terms of the interstate, but it actually is two slivers. So they had a piece of farmland, a decent piece of farmland. The interstate came along and took away 98% of the value of the property. They were left with a little sliver that's very wet, which is where the homeless encampment is, right by the sewage treatment plant, and then another sliver on the other side of the interstate, which is also very wet, right by the river. That's the one that the U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service wants. So I don't know when they stopped paying taxes, but it wouldn't surprise me if it was 1960s. Once the interstate was built, they had something that had no value whatsoever. There's literally 20 of these along the interstate, and so it's a long-term focus to try to deal with these things.
Okay.
The numbers are tiny. It's messy on our tax rolls.
Okay.
This one, because the city owns part of it, makes sense to add to our property. As Council Murphy said, the police are actually happy for it to be in city hands because gives them more authority. The other one, the reason Fish and Wildlife Service wants it is they own on three sides. So that property east side of the interstate is literally like a tenth of an acre.
Okay.
The only reason they want it is because they own all around and they're willing to come on.
No, protect it. Right. Okay. Yeah. Thank you.
The other thing this helps with is because, I mean, when the state, when they took the land for 91, they left this piece. But because it's still there, the assessors have to keep track of it. It wound up in tax title. I mean, they have to treat this property in the records like it's a valuable piece of property and go to the trouble of taking care of it. So the other thing this solves is it gets it out of the system. They can drop it. They don't have to monitor it. I mean, it probably costs more effort to keep track of this by the assessors and the collector than you ever get. And the owner of it says, it's worthless. You know, it's a little sliver in a swamp by 91. I'm not going to pay the taxes on it. So really, it helps us all around to get this out of the system.
Thank you, Wayne.
So any more questions on this one? All in favor of a positive recommendation?
Aye.
Please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed? Good. And then the last one is upon the recommendation of the mayor, whereas the city council appropriated $100,000 in the FY14 capital plan for the installation of an elevator to enhance handicapped accessibility at the Forbes Library based on an original estimate of $300,000 for the project. And whereas Forbes Library has raised $200,000 in donation for the handicapped entrance project, and whereas the first round of bids came in high, the project specifications were revised, and the second round of bids has resulted in a projected total cost of $399,900, resulting in the need for additional funds to see the project through completion. Therefore, order that $99,900 be appropriated from the stabilization fund for the purposes of installing an elevator at the entrance to Forbes Library that will replace the current lift currently used by patrons to access the first floor from the underground entrance level. So do we have a recommendation, Finance?
A recommendation.
Second?
Second.
Mm-hmm. And this poor thing has come to capital improvements for a couple of years. I mean, the problem is we don't really have handicapped accessibility to our library anymore. And this has come for several years, and the bids keep coming in high, and it's something that we've approved and approved and approved because we've got to get people with mobility issues in the library. And I'll have the mayor ask any more questions or answer any more questions.
I think the order...
favor?
Aye.
Thank you.
So we reconvene, and actually, just a note, Ms. Galina, I just want to let you know, I noticed that you've been standing here waiting, and I just want to let you know that the vote coming up on Middle Street is actually to refer it. It won't be to accept or approve.
So it actually came, it's already been to finance.
What's the,
To ordinance.
It has been to ordinance?
Yeah.
Yes.
It actually has been there.
Oh, okay.
And I'm happy to, if you let me.
Okay, good. Well, all right, you're welcome to stick around. It does.
Councilor Donald can help me with this. If you recall, it came up at transportation and parking when Alex brought it up and said, why is this still floating around? Mm. And at that point, it got modified and sent to ordinance with eliminating the three restriction on the three spaces near Chestnut Street. And then finance back here, but it was delayed coming back here because I wanted to write the residents on Middle Street to say, okay, if we eliminate the three spaces at the end of Middle Street by Chestnut and only basically restrict the spaces from Nora's driveway, because they're the first house on Middle Street, the three spaces near Chestnut, that house faces Chestnut, so there's no driveway, there's no coming and going. So that was modified at ordinance and then sent back here, but not to come on the agenda till I had a chance to write Middle Street and say, is this okay with you? Do you like this the way it is? And they responded yes, so that's why it's back on the agenda.
So the this comes with a recommendation from ordinance or not?
Yes.
It does.
It had already been there.
Very good.
But it was just some confusion when it came back here because it had been so long waiting for the letters. And
but I think it came from ordinance with no
change.
Recommendation.
Okay.
But it's been there.
We'll address that as we come up. Yeah. I just, yeah. if she was going to have to sit here and then just to see a
it,
rather.
Yeah, it came back basically. Okay. It was there and it got sent back
all right.
here, but it doesn't have to go back.
I don't think any citizen should be punished enough to sit here for an entire meeting. Exactly. So first up is, this is an order to modify the council rules. This comes upon the recommendation of Councilor Jesse Adams and William H. Dwight. Order that the following changes to the city council rules are adopted. Works Committee. This is the establishment of the Public Works Committee. A, the duties and responsibilities of the Public Works Committee shall provide the means for direct exchange of information and regular communication between the City Council and the Department of Public Works. And number two, the committee may require any member of a multiple member body or any city employee to appear before it to give any information relevant to Public Works that the committee may require in relation to the municipal services, functions, powers, or duties which are within the scope of responsibility of that person and are not within the jurisdiction of the school committee. The committee shall give a minimum of 7 days notice to a person it may require to appear before it under this section. The notice shall include specific questions on which the committee seeks information, and no person called to appear before the committee under this section shall be required to respond to any question not relevant or related to those questions presented in advance and in writing. The committee will notify the mayor of any information requests under this section. B, membership. The committee shall consist of three city councilors, and the meetings, the committee shall meet at the request of the chair or at the request of two city councilors. I'll accept a motion to put this on the floor.
Move to approve.
Second.
This comes, Councilor Adams is kind enough to draft this because this comes in as we reintroduce the administrative orders, and we were eliminating in the new administrative orders the ability to actually have a liaison committee that is currently existing. I will state up front that it is my intention that the current members of the liaison committee would comprise this committee. But the purpose of this is so that, as it states, so that we can continue to at least have a channel by which we're going to have some very serious issues coming before us. Now we're bearing some significant responsibilities that people have expressed concerns. Former members of the Board of Public Works have expressed concerns as well. And this is to have some members of our body have a more in-depth and grittier knowledge and understanding of the issues so that they can help us in our deliberations. Councilor Carney.
Can we vote on this tonight, or is it important that is it required that we refer this to the ordinance rules and appointments committee. Can we vote on this as a change in our rules tonight?
This actually is a motion to vote as opposed
to
this
refer.
Is modifying our rules.
Okay. So no, there's no requirement to refer.
Okay.
Any further discussion on this issue? Any questions? Yeah, let's do a roll call.
Councilor O'Donnell.
Yes.
Councilor Shearer.
Yes.
Councilor Spector.
Yes.
Councilor Adams.
Yes.
Councilor Carney.
Yes.
Councilor Dwight.
Yes.
Councilor Klein.
Yes.
Councilor Labarge.
Yes.
Councilor Murphy.
Yes.
That passes in first reading, and the next item is visited in the meeting on the 18th.
A point of question regarding the other next items that we're dealing with. Since you brought up the issue of Middle Street and the one resident is here, I'm wondering if it makes sense to bump that further.
Are there any objections?
Otherwise, it will be
that's
many
good.
I don't get you.
All right. Then that's what we'll do.
That's just a, just let, a gesture of kindness.
We'll let poor Pam catch up.
Good. You're right.
You good?
I think that's great.
Let me see. I'm going to call up the paper down. Oh, God.
It's way at the end.
It's way at the end.
Yeah, that's why I asked, because it's
she's
like the last item.
You got a copy?
Yeah, right.
Thank you. Well, now I got copies on my ear.
See, there's that. Actually.
Okay. Okay. It's upon the recommendation of the Transportation and Parking Commission, and apparently it's an ordinance of the City of Northampton, Massachusetts, providing the code of ordinances of the City of Northampton, Massachusetts, to be amended by revising section 312-1032 of said code, provided that no parking at certain times be it ordained by the City Council of the City of Northampton, the City Council assembled as follows, that section 312-103-2 of the code of ordinances of the City of Northampton, Massachusetts, be amended so that such section shall be as follows. Add Middle Street westerly from Chester Street northerly, 632 feet on the westerly side of Middle Street, that a 2-hour parking from 8 a.m. to 6 p.m. daily be established. I'll accept the motion to put that on the floor for purposes of discussion. Is there a second?
I second it.
Councilor Murphy.
So, for those of you that have been around for a while, this first showed up actually 3 terms ago, and it's hold again after the spaces were marked, and there, hence the delay from when this came out of ordinance till now. What came from Traffic and Transportation was a recommendation that, well, hey, maybe what we'll do is leave the 3 spaces that aren't in front of anybody's house right up at Chestnut Street, the closest one to the medical building, unrestricted, so they can still park in those 3 spaces all day. But from the first driveway on Middle Street, which happens to be Nora's driveway, down to about number 41, which is where the people were interested in having this ordinance, that would be 2-hour parking from 8 to 6. So they'll get 3 spaces on the corner, free and clear, whenever they want to park there. But in front of people's houses, it would be restricted. That, coupled with the fact that one of the major tenants in the medical building, which was a mental health operation that had a lot of come and go, they have since moved somewhere else. So the demand has gone down a little bit. So the thought is, with the three spaces on the corner and the drop in demand, and we just restrict the spaces in front of the houses, it probably will work okay. And so that's where we're at this point. But I think Councilor Carney, you'll remember, and Councilor Spector, three terms, and Councilor DeVars, three terms ago, was when this first started. It's just the process has taken a long time to get it reasonable, so it helps the residents. It gives a couple of spaces to the medical building, but it's sort of a compromise that has been years in the making, but I think it's finally there.
Yeah. Councilor Adams.
I'm slightly concerned because I remember at last term the business community had an awful lot to say about it. Mm-hmm. And now no one's here, combined with the fact that it was put on the agenda for referral. I'm concerned maybe they don't know about it, because actually, they had a lot. There were petitions circulated. Mm-hmm. There was an awful lot to be said about it.
Exactly. Actually, the letter that I sent, and Nora got one that said this would be tonight, I also gave to one of the building owners to share with the tenants in the building. I think it's more or less a function of the fact that it hasn't been as bad a problem, because with one of the tenants changing in the building, the demand is not that what it used to be. So it seems to be a more livable situation now.
One of the people who came in the past was the liaison to the building who spoke with her for all the businesses. Was that specific? Is that specific person still there, and was she notified?
I don't know, because I gave one of the building owners a copy of the letter that I sent to the residents. If you if you want to recognize Nora, perhaps she knows.
Is there
a motion to recognize Ms.?
She's not there anymore. And when I've had problems, none of the liaison actually didn't make themselves known to the community until I pushed it. And then they made themselves known, and then she left, and then we didn't know that. So I had problems, so I reached out to Dr. Tassoni, who was somewhat helpful. He's a very nice man, but there is no liaison. Thanks.
And if you'd like, before second reading, I'm happy to get to the building owner again and say, hey, I gave you the letter. You share it with the people. Do they know what's going on? But I think it's this process has gone on so long. I think now they got a different tenant mix in the building. The demand's not so high. They're getting a couple of spaces. They're really the closest ones to the building on the street that will not be restricted at all, so they can still use those. So I think basically it's gotten to the point where it's okay. But I'm happy to make an extra effort to make sure that
if I may, actually, to that point, and my concern is more to what Councilor Adams is alluding to. Mm-hmm. On our agenda, it's only posted as a referral. So in order to conform with Mass General Open Meeting Law, it is, someone can make a fair case.
It's been almost 6 years.
No,
it doesn't bother me if it hangs around another.
Well, that's what I was going to say was that I think, since we're supposed to be voting on a referral, this is what I would recommend, is that since we're removing the referral as a recommendation, but to vote on the ordinance, I would defer that to the next meeting, subject to two readings.
As you wish.
Motion to postpone to the December 18th meeting.
Second. Okay. For your purposes, just so you understand, this is actually a formality that we're obliged to abide by because of Mass General Law. It is not going to change or alter the disposition of the decision, which wouldn't be finally rendered until the 18th anyway. So,
just a question, and to the maker of the motion, is this postponement made also with the understanding that we're looking for two readings at the next meeting? Is that what I understood? Because otherwise, we're going to the next session.
I don't think it matters for midterm purposes, but I don't think it matters for the purpose of the motion. I mean, we can certainly take it.
Well, only because I think that to get at what we're trying to do here, I'm assuming that what we want to do is do an additional outreach to the Dr. Tassoni, to the medical practice, to any other business or community who would come again to mm-hmm. let them know to come again that they have one more opportunity, and whether that's one more opportunity or two, I think would be helpful for them to know.
I mean,
you're the only The only issue is,
it was
our attempt to get this done before the street needs to be plowed, because this does somehow, this does affect access on the street a little bit, so it would be nice to get it done before it really is winter, which is why the goal was to communicate with them in the fall.
But then worst comes to worst, it would be at the next meeting would be a first reading, and in January would be a second reading.
Right.
Okay.
So in this case, the motion is, as Councilor Adams said, is to postpone, and when this comes back, it will not be for referral, it will be actually to vote on this issue, either one or two readings on the 18th. So all those in favor of Councilor Adams' motion, please say aye.
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 Any opposed? Any abstentions? Okay, thank you. Thank you. You're welcome to stay for the rest of the stuff. It's just as compelling. Next up is the order to accept the donation of the granite mileage markers. And this is in first reading. I'll accept a motion.
Second.
Okay. Any further discussion on this? Beyond the discussion in finance, all those in favor, please say aye.
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 Roll call.
Roll call. Sorry, I'm working on an order. It's a financial order. Roll call, please.
Councilor Sheriff.
Yes.
Councilor Spector.
Yes.
Councilor Adams?
Yes.
Councilor Carney?
Yes.
Councilor Dwight?
Yes.
Councilor Klein?
Yes.
Councilor Labarge?
Yes.
Councilor Murphy?
Yes.
Councilor O'Donnell?
Yes.
That passes in first reading. It will come back to us on the 18th. Second up is, third up actually, is the order to acquire land from Peter Bay. I'll accept a motion, put this on the
floor. Move to approve.
I second.
Any further discussion on this item? Roll call.
Councilor Spector.
Yes.
Councilor Adams.
Yes.
Councilor Carney.
Yes.
Councilor Dwight.
Yes.
Councilor Klein.
Yes.
Councilor Labarge.
Yes.
Councilor Murphy.
Yes.
Councilor O'Donnell.
Yes.
Councilor Sheriff.
Yes.
Next up is the order to accept the deed in lieu of foreclosure. Accept a motion.
So moved.
Second. Any further discussion?
Second. Opportunities much easier. Thank you for consideration of this request. And I also want to say that, which I know all of us counselors know because we've gone to the fundraising, that Mike and Judith Ryan, who and their group of volunteers who worked tirelessly doing this fundraiser for the library, and I want to thank them because they raised $200,000 and they really did work hard. So, and then knowing that after they raised that money, that when they went to put it out to bid, it was much higher than what they thought. So we need this money. It is very crucial, very valuable for people with disabilities that this goes through.
Any other discussion? Okay, roll call, please.
Councilor Carney.
Yes.
Councilor Dwight.
Yes.
Councilor Klein.
Yes.
Councilor Labarge.
Yes.
Councilor Murphy.
Yes.
Councilor O'Donnell.
Yes.
Councilor Sheriff.
Yes.
Councilor Spector.
Yep.
Councilor Adams.
Yes.
Now we come up to the second readings, which you approved at the last meeting. These are the petitions to accept certain roadways as public ways. I don't know if you want to move them as a group.
Please move
them as a group.
Motion's made to move them as a group. Clark Street, Cook Avenue, and Massasoit Avenue. Would you like me to read all the documentation as listed?
No.
You've said enough.
Second it.
Boy, everyone in the audience is saying no.
Oh, right.
Clark Street, there was an amendment.
Yes, the amendment for.
So the motion's made with, as amended?
As amended.
Yes.
Okay.
That was Massasoit that was amended, but there was another street acceptance that had listed as Clark at the top, but in.
It was a typo.
So we made that change and that's what.
So that was just a Scrivener's error?
Scrivener's error.
With those Scrivener's errors.
Well, the Scrivener's errors and as amended, so the motion, is that the motion?
Yes, I did.
Any further discussion on these petitions?
Counselor Dwight?
Yes.
Counselor Klein?
Yes.
Counselor LaBarge?
Yes.
Counselor Murphy?
Yes.
Counselor O'Donnell?
Yes.
Counselor Shara?
Yes.
Counselor Spector?
Yes.
Counselor Rollins?
Yes.
Counselor Carney?
Yes.
Coming up next, this is also in second reading. Okay, this is the ordinances in support of Mayor Narkowitz's administrative orders, actions, and amendments. I assume that you all had an opportunity to review these the last time. It is significant. It's the bulk of this document right here.
Could you read the entire document?
I would be glad to. No, the motion's been made already to move them as a group. Is
okay. Yes.
Second?
A second.
Second, okay. All right. Any further discussion on these? Oh, boy. Roll call, please.
Counselor Klein?
Yes.
Counselor LaBarge?
Yes.
Counselor Murphy?
Yes.
Counselor O'Donnell?
Yes.
Counselor Shara?
Yes.
Counselor Spector?
Yes.
Counselor Adams?
Yes.
Counselor Carney?
Yes.
Counselor Dwight?
Yes. Thank you all for your work on that last time.
Can these next?
Next up, we have some parking prohibitions on Pleasant Street.
These are to be referred.
These are referrals. Actually, no, I'm sorry. The first one up is second reading. It's the parking prohibition all times on Pleasant Street.
Can 281 and 282 go together?
Right. So you want to move them as a group?
Those two, yes.
Motion's been made to move them as a group.
Second.
And seconded. All right, this is parking prohibitions all time on Pleasant Street. This comes with a positive recommendation from TPC. Of course.
Call it a ordinance.
It's just, well, no, it's actually calling for a referral to ordinance.
That's what it's calling.
Oh.
It is? It's not on mine.
So it's not, but it's.
It's a second reading. It's a second reading.
Second reading.
Well, how can it be a second reading and a referral?
Yeah, how can you have both?
It's a typo.
Yeah, it's not a referral.
And you'll see that on number two.
It was positive recommendation from both of those committees.
Got it.
The refer is actually, should be stricken from the record.
Clearly, that's a mistake when you've already taken a first reading.
Right, you've already done.
We did make positive recommendations from these.
I don't think anybody could misunderstood this.
Yes.
All right, well, we'll throw caution to the wind and it's on me. All right. And I wasn't even there. So, you know, bring your slings and arrows. I have broad shoulders. I'm prepared to take it. So the motions were made for second reading.
Doesn't even say it.
For 281 and 282.
Says it on the park.
Yeah.
Just so you know, it doesn't even say a referral when you go on to the site. It's only on the hard copy that I think it says referral. So.
Good.
No, I'm not hearing when the site referred to.
Okay. All right, we're good. We're good.
On the amended one, it is.
It's all right.
260.
I know it's. So, any further discussion on.
Agenda for the public.
Counselors? Okay. Any further discussion on these?
No.
Roll call, please.
Counselor LaBarge?
Yes.
Counselor Murphy?
Yes.
Counselor O'Donnell?
Yes.
Counselor Shara?
Yes.
Counselor Spector?
Yes.
Counselor Adams?
Yes.
Counselor Carney?
Yes.
Counselor Dwight?
Yes.
Counselor Klein?
Yes.
Next up, we have the ordinances regarding 7 units plus in URB and URC district.
Move second reading.
Second.
And second on second reading. Any further discussion on this? Okay. Roll call, please.
Counselor Murphy?
Yes.
Counselor O'Donnell?
Yes.
Counselor Shara?
Yes.
Counselor Spector?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Counselor Adams?
Yes.
Counselor Carney? Yes. Counselor Dwight?
Yes.
Counselor Klein?
Yes.
Counselor Labarge?
Yes.
Next up is an ordinance for repealing parking prohibitions prohibited at all times for a section of New South Street. This is to refer to ordinance and transportation and parking.
No, it's upon recommendation from the body to refer to that.
No, it's from the mayor.
It's from the mayor.
Oh, I'm sorry, I'm reading.
We're not doing Middle Street. We skipped over that.
Second.
Point of order?
Four moves to refer.
Is this where they moved the crosswalk? I think that's what it is.
Yes.
This is correct. To put the spaces back.
My understanding is, yeah, they moved the crosswalk, so.
The New South Street crosswalk, other people might refer to it as the yellow barrels. Or they have other names for it that we can't repeat here on, in public, anyway. Counselor Klein, do you have your hand up on this?
No.
Nope.
All right, so this is to refer, motions to refer to ordinance and TPC. We have a motion and a second. So all those in favor of referral, please say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? I have no updates, and I assume there's no information requests.
Nope.
So what our order is I'll accept the motion to adjourn.
Move to adjourn.
Second.
All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Any abstentions? Thank you all very much.